Often we make decisions based on how we feel rather than facts or reason, while not even fully understanding why we feel that way. Cinema is filled with examples of feelings influencing decisions. Let's look at one from Paul Thomas Anderson's epic set in the early 20th century American West, There Will Be Blood. Daniel Plainview, played by Daniel Day-Lewis, is a silver miner who happens to discover oil and embarks on a systemic and ruthless approach to mastering the oil business. Plainview launches a campaign to convince small-town property owners that they should let him drill their land, making the case that without him, they won't have the equipment to access the profit beneath their feet. But uncharacteristic to his ruthless and self-centered personality, he keeps his adopted son at the forefront of his business campaign, and we see many of his clients being persuaded by the softer touch of a family man image rather than his hard bargaining. This human tendency to make decisions based on feelings and emotions that Daniel Plainview so masterfully exploits is referred to by psychologists as affect heuristic. In this video, we take a look at how affect heuristic works, how it impacts our decisions, and how we can use it to our advantage and avoid its risks. You can find the transcripts of this video and all the academic sources on gonudgeyourself.com. And remember, if you like the video, subscribe to the channel for more videos on human mind, brain, and behaviors. Now, let's get started. Affect is defined as the specific quality of goodness or badness that we experience as feelings. Now, these feelings often work at an unconscious level, and even at times when we are aware of them, we may not identify their sources or triggers. Affect is characterized by its valence, that is positive or negative, and arousal, that is low or high activation. Now, affect heuristic is defined as the tendency to make decisions based on affective and emotional responses or gut feelings. Researchers have found that when we have a pleasant feeling about something, we find its benefits to be high and risks to be low. For example, that colleague that you really like, even their faults are so adorable, aren't they? On the other hand, when people have a negative feeling about something, they perceive the risks to be high and benefits to be low. For example, that person that you just can't trust, doesn't matter how much good they do, they always have an ulterior motive, don't they? Now, one of the early studies that threw light on the workings of the affect heuristic involved exposing participants to the image of either a smiling face, a frowning face, or a neutral shape for about 0.004 seconds, followed by being shown a Chinese character for 2 seconds, and then asked to rate the character on a scale of liking. Researchers found that participants preferred the character preceded with a smiling face as opposed to those preceded by a frowning face or the neutral shape, despite the fact that smiling face was shown for an amount of time which wasn't enough for the participants to be even consciously aware of it. So how does this tendency exactly work? Well, let's start by looking at its cognitive causes, which are the psychological mechanisms that explain the affect heuristic. A number of researchers subscribe to the dual process theory, which proposes that there are two fundamentally different but complementary modes of thinking and decision making: analytical and experiential. While experiential system is oriented towards immediate action and is driven by affect, analytical system is oriented towards planning and evaluating and is driven by logic. Now, rather than one system being superior to the other, both systems are well adapted to certain decision contexts, giving us behavioral flexibility. Next, our brains are always predicting how things will impact us and preparing themselves and the body for these impacts. So if a person gave us a cake last time we met them, our brain predicts receiving a cake if we meet them again or even think about them, and prepares our body for a rush of sugar. We feel these bodily changes based on predictions of the brain as affect. Positive or negative feelings for predictions of benefits or harms, and low and high arousal for predictions of how much bodily resources will be required. So affect represents our predictions about objects rather than properties of the objects themselves. But very commonly, we are unable to tell the difference between the two, and therefore we believe that objects and people in the world are inherently negative or positive. This phenomenon is known as affective realism and is closely related to DiMaggio's somatic marker hypothesis. And finally, the affect as spotlight hypothesis, proposes that affect guides our information search while making decisions. Individuals who have positive feelings about an object will spend more time looking at its benefits than risks and will remember the benefits better. This biased information search is something that contributes to confirmation bias as well. Go check out that video on the channel. Next, let's see what's going on in the brain when we are making decisions based on affect. The affective system in our brains is quite sophisticated and involves multiple brain regions and levels of processing. Firstly, the amygdala stores emotional memories, which help in predicting outcomes based on what we are perceiving, while nucleus accumbens is involved in creating motivational states based on these predictions. The internal states of the body are represented in terms of affective information in the insula, also referred to as the interoceptive cortex. The emotional, motivational, and affective information from all these brain regions is integrated in the orbitofrontal cortex, where it informs decision making. Now, all these brain regions are densely interconnected and influence each other in both directions. But why does this tendency exist? After all, for it to be passed down to us from our ancestors, either genetically or culturally, it must be beneficial at least in certain conditions. Well, firstly, while analysis is certainly important in some decision-making circumstances, reliance on affect and emotions is a quicker, easier, and more efficient way of navigating a complex, uncertain, and sometimes dangerous world. After all, you don't want to be calculating the speed of an approaching predator. You want to be running away at the very hint of it. Next, affect plays an important role in triggering action. Judgments based on affect have a motivational component that can be lacking from purely analytical judgments. For example, you may cognitively understand the problem of homelessness, but you're unlikely to do something about it unless you feel emotionally compelled to. And finally, affect acts as a common currency, allowing people to literally compare apples to oranges. By converting complex thoughts into simpler affective judgments of good or bad feelings, we can compare objects and ideas which are otherwise too dissimilar for any sort of analytical comparison. Next, let's look at situations where affect heuristic is not well suited for decision making and can actually lead to bad decisions. Firstly, affect heuristic makes us believe that risks and benefits are inversely related. That is, if we perceive the benefits of something to be high, we automatically underestimate its risks and vice versa. But very often, risks and benefits in our environment are positively related. That is, one being high means that the other is also likely to be high. For example, hunting a larger prey is riskier, but also more rewarding as it feeds more individuals. Similarly, sugary foods are more rewarding, but riskier in terms of addiction and their impact on health. Secondly, when expected outcomes carry sharp and strong affective meanings, as is the case with a large reward like a lottery jackpot or a terminal disease like cancer, we become blind to the actual likelihood of these outcomes. For example, our attitude towards something that has a 5% chance of leading to cancer doesn't differ very much from something that has a 50% chance, because the negative effect of cancer is too overpowering for us to think about its probability. Now, this tendency is referred to as probability neglect. Next, the affective system evolved to deal with direct first-hand experiences, which are limited to smaller amounts and smaller changes in our environment. After all, at a given moment, we can only deal with limited amount of information. So the affective system is not well adapted towards larger changes and larger quantities. As a result, we are unable to intuitively grasp exponential growth, such as the rate of growth of pandemics like COVID-19. Also, our insensitivity towards large numbers means that we may fail to respond adequately to famines, poverty, and diseases that afflict large number of people, as these numbers may just end up becoming stats to us. For example, the difference between one death and 100 deaths may seem big to us in terms of its emotional impact, but the emotional impact of 100,000 deaths and 200,000 deaths may not differ very much, because both are very large numbers which are very hard for us to process emotionally. This tendency is known as psychophysical numbing. Next, affect is based on averages and stereotypes derived from the sum of all our experiences with a particular stimulus. Now, these stereotypes or symbolic meanings may override the specific evidence available to us in a given situation. For example, nature is generally perceived as something positive and pristine. So threats with natural causes, such as a pandemic, may be underestimated and associated more with the inevitability of the event or acceptance of natural cycles. On the other hand, threats with human causes, such as the risks of nuclear energy, may be associated with irresponsibility, apathy or malice, and therefore overestimated. Next, the affective system is designed to make sense of things that are close to us in time and space. It does not do as well with things that are temporally, physically, or socially distant. This leads to insensitivity towards slow change like global warming or distant events like genocide in another country. And finally, effective decision-making exposes us to manipulation through marketing tactics. Once we form a brand preference, we start overvaluing the benefits of its products and underestimating their risks. Similarly, when the benefits of our product are communicated with strong effect, they can compensate for its shortcomings, which may not be as effective. And finally, let's look at some of the ways we can have effect heuristic work in our favor instead of against us. Firstly, the evaluability principle states that the impact of effect on decision making is stronger when there is a clear evaluation criteria in the decision context. For example, the size of the container of food becomes an evaluation criteria for the quantity of food. So a half-filled container is less, while a fully or overfilled container is more. But what if we compare an overfilled small container with an underfilled larger one? Well, this leads to the less is more effect, where people often prefer the overfilled smaller container. Without a context to give effective perspective to quantities of money, food, and even lives, these quantities may not convey enough meaning. Secondly, for quantitative information, frequency formats are more effect-laden than percentages. For example, to increase the effective meaning of 20% chance of death, it can be reframed as 1 out of 5 people are likely to die. Now, effective impact can be increased further by using imagery or individualized narrative. For example, 800,000 killed in the last 100 days can be broken down and reframed as 1 life lost every 11 seconds. Both the 1 life lost and the near-time horizon of every 11 seconds are more effective. Another example, in a rally to get the US Congress to do something about 38,000 deaths a year from handguns, the organizers piled 38,000 pairs of shoes in a mound in front of the Capitol. Next, once an effective association is created, it exists separately from the information or logic that led to it. So, if new information is provided, invalidating the original information, the effective association will still remain unimpacted unless the new information is also strongly effective and opposite in balance. So basically, only effect can negate effect. Next, our reliance on effective decision making increases with time scarcity and other environmental stressors that deplete our mental bandwidth. So, unless an important decision is extremely urgent, it is always a good idea to mull over it a bit to balance both analytical and effective evaluations. And finally, we deliberately manipulate our own affective states all the time. And researchers have found that our attempts are actually successful. That is, they do lead to change in affective states. We do this when we expect that an adjustment in our affective state will lead to an improvement in our performance at a certain task. Indeed, studies have shown that people sometimes induce or maintain negative affective states in situations where they expect that negative mood will be beneficial for decision making. And to conclude, let's look back at the story of Daniel Plainview. Plainview understood that reason and logic are far from sufficient to persuade people, and what he needed for success was to lower people's guard and make them trust him. To this end, he used his adopted son to project a trustworthy family man image. This image helped Plainview manipulate local landowners into selling him their valuable properties for a pittance. Go watch this masterpiece for the story of Daniel Plainview's greed and ambition. And now it's your turn. Tell us in the comments below how effect heuristic has influenced your decisions. And remember to like the video, subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you next time.